So today's lecture is about what I think is almost certainly the best known real life example of abelian anions, and that is the quantum Hall effect. Last time we discussed the Kataev-Torrick code, but of course that's right now that's basically a theorist model written on paper and not, at least as far as I know, actually realized in real life experiments. The quantum Hall effect, by contrast, is very much a real life experimental system. It's been around now, well, in integral form since 1980, I guess, and in the fractional form since 1983. So there's really been 30 years worth of work on that, and the literature is actually quite sophisticated and complicated. I certainly won't have time to review all of it by any means. So it's just basically try to get across the main points concerning the quantum Hall effect. Okay, so let's start by just thinking a little about the concept of Hall resistance. I suppose we have a slab. We will be talking, perhaps I should emphasize right away, we're going to be talking in this lecture, and indeed in most of this course, about systems which can be regarded as two-dimensional. So any degree of freedom normal to the plane of the screen is supposed to be frozen out by going to sufficiently low temperatures and so forth. And that really does seem to be the case in most of the experimental systems we're going to consider. So we have this sheet of metal, let's say, with a width W and a length L. And we can, quite generally, we can define resistances and conductances in the following way. We have to be quite careful about this definition. What experimentalists tend to do is to impose constant currents and then measure voltages. So for any given set of currents across various directions across this sheet, we can define the voltage across different edges here. Now, you notice that I've explicitly written sum sub I here. The reason for that is that I want to use the expression sigma for the conductance. It is the standard. The standard notation, but of course if I also use it for a sum, people are going to get confused. So I've written explicitly, it's the sum over I of a resistance tensor Rij times Ij. And so that's what experimentalists would usually do. They'd apply a particular currents and measure the resultant voltages. Theorists, by and large, tend to do the opposite. That is that they tend to imagine that you applied a given voltage and measured the current. Again, you have to treat the conductance here as a tensor in general. So the tensor, sigma, conductance tensor, incidentally, important point about this whole business of the quantum Hall effect is that, generally speaking, in traditional condensed matter physics, when you're discussing three-dimensional solids and so forth, you tend to work in terms of what I call ivities, that is, you work in terms of conductivity and resistivity, right? Now, in the case of the quantum Hall effect, it's actually much more useful to think in terms of ANSIs, that is, conductances and resistances, not conductivities and resistivities, and you'll see why in a minute. So these are actually ANSIs, resistances and conductances. So the conductance tensor, then, is the matrix inverse of the resistance tensor. And that has a number of consequences, some of which may seem at first sight slightly counterintuitive. First of all, if the off-diagonal elements of the conductance are non-zero, then you can actually have simultaneously the longitudinal resistance equal to zero and the longitudinal conductance equal to zero. And to see why that's not a paradox, you have to remember how you define these beasts here. That is, the resistance is defined for zero transverse current, whereas the conductance is defined for zero transverse voltage. So there's no contradiction here. Second point is that if the longitudinal conductance is zero, then in fact the transverse conductivity is just the conductance is just the inverse of the resistance. Finally, under most normal circumstances, and certainly under the circumstances we're going to be discussing, the conductance tensor, and hence the resistance tensor, is antisymmetric. I think that's intuitively fairly obvious because essentially the fact that you've got a transverse conductance at all is going to be a function of the magnetic field. If you think about the symmetries of the possible tensors involved and the way in which they define that, they involve the magnetic field, then you see it's basically a sort of cross-product structure, so that you have to have this. So now we're going to define explicitly the Hall resistance, RYX, which is the ratio of the voltage across the Y faces to the current along the X direction, given that the current in this direction is zero. Now, in two dimensions, the conductance, the resistance and the resistivity have the same dimension. In fact, the voltage here is just the width times the electric field in the Y direction. By definition, the Y electric field under these circumstances is the resistivity times the current density. The current density is I divided by the width, and therefore the Hall resistance is equal to the Hall resistivity in two dimensions, independently of the sample dimensions. On the other hand, you can't make the same statement for the longitudinal resistivities that is there a factor of L over W, which in general is not one. There's a more general statement you can make. Let's consider a rather general situation in which we simply postulate that the X component of conductance is zero. We'll see in a moment why that's not so absurd. Longitudinal component of conductance is zero. The transverse component of conductivity is a constant. Okay, so we've got a general situation like this with no particular symmetry. However, what is essential here is that we're going to apply voltage leads here and here, current leads here and here, so that the voltage path and the current path intersect one another. That's really that's, as it were, a topological statement. That's the important statement here. Okay. So now we're going to measure the current here, and that's the integral of the perpendicular component of the current density across this line here. But that, by definition, is the Hall conductivity. You've got sigma xx equals zero, remember? So that current here is the Hall conductivity times the longitudinal component of electric field. That then, when you integrate it, means that I is minus sigma xy times vh. And so that what that says is that since by definition the Hall resistance is V over I, that means that the Hall resistance, the general four-terminal resistance, is sigma yx to minus 1. And by hypothesis that quantity is constant, it's a function of space. So that's just a number. You see, the nice thing about this is that this result is completely independent of the geometry, provided only that you've got this, if you like, topological constraint satisfied that the current path crosses the voltage path. Okay, so far? Okay, let's talk a bit about the systems involved in the experiments. The oldest experiments were done on silicon MOSFETs. The more recent ones are usually done on gallium arsenide, aluminum gallium arsenide heterostructures. Here's a very crude diagram of a silicon MOSFET. I've got silicon here, a metal here, SiO2 here. And if you think about the band bending, of course this is a very old topic, goes right back to the 30s and so forth, people thought about this and they realised that there would be that with an appropriate voltage applied, There would be a so-called inversion layer here. That is a region where electrons could accumulate at the edge of the silicon here. Now, of course, in general, those electrons are going to have states and energy levels which have a particular dispersion in this direction, perpendicular to the surface, and a particular dispersion along the surface. However, provided the density is low enough, and it usually is in these experiments, there's only a single transverse level populated. That is, the motion in this direction is confined to the ground state. The aluminum here. The two-dimensional slab in this picture would be this, in this direction. Yes.
So the electrons are accumulating on the top of the.
If I look at this, let me think, what's the easiest way to look at this? So my silicon is with certain impurities. Is on the right. The aluminum is sort of irrelevant. Really, it's just there to provide an appropriate counter link. SiO2 slab down here. So there's symmetry in this direction and this direction. The only asymmetry is in this direction. If I've doped the thing right and applied the right kind of potentials, then what I find is that there's a sort of sheet of electrons accumulated in this plane here. That's what we're going to be talking about. The theory of how one gets to this is actually somewhat non-trivial, and this is the subject of lots and lots of textbooks going right back to the 30s and so forth, but I think the results are pretty well established by now. One slight problem when you're looking at the raw data, silicon, bulk silicon, does have a cubic structure and therefore a cubic band structure. However, it turns out that under the conditions which we're talking about, there are two different so-called valleys which are populated in the Brillouin zone. So that you just have to watch out for that complication in real life. Luckily, that's not the case for gallium, for the gallium arsenide superstructures. They just have a single valley populated. It's worth noticing the effective mass, and what's talking now, remember, always, one's sort of completely frozen out and neglected the motion in this direction. I was talking about the motion in the plane here. The effective mass is rather small compared to the bare mass of the electrons, and that will actually be important later. Typical mobilities, silicon MOSFETs go up to something like this. More recently, with the gallium arsenide super heterostructures, one's been able to go up to this kind of figure, which is really, by sort of traditional standards, rather enormous. It's a rather large mobility by any traditional standards. So crudely speaking, this means that you can treat the electron, the motion, as if you didn't have a magnetic field, say, you're just looking at the motion in this direction, you can treat the electrons as practically ballistic. That is, they make very, very few collisions. Now, we're going to apply a magnetic field perpendicular to the plane, so in this case, in this direction. And then there are two characteristic energies that become important. One is the Zeeman energy, which is the usual G factor, which typically is order 1. We'll see in a moment what it is, times this number EH bar over 2m. And remember here, this is the real mass, not the effective mass here. The cyclotron energy is EH bar B over m star, the effective mass here. Now, important point, G is typically of order 1. In fact, for these systems, it's about 0.5. And the mass ratio for gallium arsenide is about 0.07 here. And that means, you put those numbers in here, that means that the Zeeman energy is only about a 60th of the cyclotron energy. So that means, for accounting purposes, the relevant number of electrons which we're going to be worried about is not the total number, but the number per spin, and in the case of silicon, per valley. That's just a matter of accounting, so we just make sure we take care of it. Okay, conditions to see the quantum Hall effect. Why wasn't it seen before 1980, or at least not seen clearly before 1980? Well, the conditions really are quite severe. The scattering time has to be long compared to the cyclotron frequency. So semi-classically, an electron has to be able to form several orbits in the magnetic field before it suffers any collision process. A slightly different condition is that the mean free path, L, must be large compared to the magnetic length. The magnetic length is just this quantity here. And notice that this depends only on fundamental constants and on the magnetic field, not on the materials parameters. And typically for a magnetic field of 1 tesla, put in that number, for a magnetic field of 1 tesla, that number is about 250 angstroms, in fact. So large compared to typical atomic separations, but still small compared to the dimensions of your sample. Third condition, the thermal energy has to be small compared to the cyclotron energy, so that you don't get, sometimes, mixing of different cyclotron states. The density per this is density per unit area, the aerial density of electrons, should be of the order of magnitude of Eb over h bar. What that says basically is that you should have of the order of 1 electron per flux quantum. The interesting point about the quantum Hall effect, and this was, I think, appreciated from the very earliest days, is that although you have all these constraints here, one constraint you don't have is any severe constraint on the geometry. You have a really rather messy sample from the point of view of its edges and so forth, and you'll still be able to see the quantum Hall effect. Now that's a telling observation, I think, quite generally. Sorry? Oh, well, okay. Unfortunately, if you try to take your plate and actually make it physically into a torus, then the problem is you're not going to be able to get your magnetic field perpendicular to it. So people, by and large, haven't done that. However, there are some interesting, quasi-variants of this. For example, one can have bilayer quantum Hall systems, and in which you actually have two sheets which are deliberately separated, possibly by some kind of dielectric or whatever. And those certainly show extremely interesting effects. Okay, just for phenomenology now of the integral quantum Hall effect. This is the original one discovered in 1980. Turns out that under appropriate conditions, the Hall conductance shows plateaus for values of the quantity n here is density, h over eb, so this is this quantity is essentially the number of electrons per flux quantum. It shows plateaus for values of that close to some integer, integer nu, and on each of these plateaus, so this is the Hall conductance, I've pointed up here, you have these plateaus, and on these plateaus, the Hall conductance is nu times e squared over h. Remember that in quite generally in mesoscopic physics, the fundamental unit of conductance is e squared over h. It has the right dimensions for that. It depends only on fundamental constants. The sigma h is nu times an integral times that, and that appears to be accurate to 1 part in 10 to the 8, as far as we know. Incidentally, the way I'm plotting things here is not, strictly speaking, the way in which traditionally this is plotted in experimental papers. People usually plot the resistance versus magnetic field along here. I think that's inconvenient, so I've turned the plot sometimes upside down here. But basically, it's the same plot. Now, important observation, over the plateaus, the longitudinal conductance is zero, with an experimental error. So that again is illustrated here. I'm afraid this diagram has got slightly displaced. The regions over which the longitudinal conductance or the longitudinal resistance equally is zero should lie under these plateaux here. Sorry, that's got slightly distorted here. Okay, so that's the integral quantum Hall effect. Now, plateaus also occur at non-integral values of nu. That is, a nu equals 1 over 2n plus 1, where n is integer. And actually, they occur more generally. Actually, this is not quite sufficiently general, as you see. They actually occur at values of nu integral equal to a rational fraction, p over q, where, however, q is almost always an odd integer. So, for example, 1/3, 1/5, but also 2/5, 4/7, etc., etc. By now, there are something like, I think, 50 different different values of nu measured at which this occurs. One very noticeable exception, which we're going to have to come back to in a later lecture, is nu equals 5/2. That does appear, as far as we know, to correspond to a genuine quantum Hall plateau with all the usual frills attached to it. However, you see that in that case, the denominator is even. So that's always been a big mystery, and we'll come back to that. Now again, in the fractional quantum Hall effect, again we find that the Hall conductance is nu times e squared over h, even though nu is not now integral, and the longitudinal conductance again is zero with an experimental error. Well, I say it's zero with an experimental error. I think a more honest statement would be that at least for some, for the better, as it were, the nicer values of nu, for example, 1/3, the original Laughlin state, it is indeed zero with an experimental error. For some of the more sophisticated ones, like, 15/11 and so forth, you tend to find it's not exactly zero. the reasons for that are not always well understood, but at least for the clean case, it's zero. Now, here's a very obvious observation. Suppose we just do the naive theory of the Hall effect. How do we do that? Well, we simply postulate that the total electric current is constant as a function of time. What would be the rate of change of the current? It would have various terms. It would have a term due to the driving by the external electric field. It would also have a term due to the Lorentz force. Now that's V. The Lorentz force, remember, is V cross B. So if you turn that into an expression involving J, it's J over NE cross B. Then you have a collision term here. Now, if you're at high enough field, that is, if omega c times tau is large compared to 1, you can basically neglect this term. That then will give you a Hall conductivity, which is simply the number of electrons per unit area times E times B to the minus 1. And that's true for general B. So in the particular case, when NH over EB is equal to nu exactly, then that will give you a Hall conductance, which is indeed nu e squared of h. Okay? So there's no mystery about the fact that at the points where this quantity is an exact integer, you get the values here, here, and here. That's nothing particularly strange. However, there are two major problems. First of all, why are the plateaus of finite length? In other words, This is still true, even when nu is not exactly an integer. It's merely close to an integer. Right? And the second point is that why should this formula apparently be accurate to 1 part in 10 to the 8th, considering that omega c times tau is always much less than that? So you'd expect that the corrections would be of order 1 over omega c times tau, and are therefore large compared to 1 part in 10 to the 8th. So those two with, as it were, a little hindsight in some sense, these two features do suggest that in some sense the Hall of, this quantum Hall effect must be topological in origin. It has to be more robust than it would be if it was just from these simple textbook considerations. Okay, so far? Sure, absolutely, yes, could be. We certainly can't exclude that a priori. However, as we'll see, as far as I don't know, no one has found one, and the topological explanation does seem to work. Yeah. So. Yep.
Does it mean that the experimentalist first couldn't find the fractional lattice, and later they could magnify that portion first?
Ah, okay, good question. I mean, why? Why did they didn't they originally see the fractional quantum Hall effect? I think I'm not totally sure about that, but I suspect the answer goes something like this: to see I actually said that to see. Just go back for a moment. I said that a condition to see the fractional the quantum Hall effect is KT much less than H bar omega C, and that's certainly a necessary condition, but it may not be a sufficient. And in fact, what turns out to be rather more stringent, it turns out that for the integral quantum Hall effect, this really is a sufficient condition as well as a necessary one. For the fractional quantum Hall effect, on the other hand, you may have energy gaps which are much less than H bar omega C. And therefore, so that would mean in turn, you have to go down to much lower temperatures in order to see it clearly. And I think that's probably the reason they didn't see it in the original 1980 experiments. But there may have been other reasons as well, I'm not too sure. Okay, so it's gone. Now we have to do a little textbook work on the quantum mechanics of a single electron in a magnetic field. Very, very, very straightforward quantum mechanics problem. The Hamiltonian is the effective mass, half times the effective mass, times the squares of the velocities. These are the actual physical kinematic velocities in the x and y direction. Now, the expression for the velocities in terms of the canonical momentum and the vector potential is this here. Now, I'm subsequently going to write, I'm going to neglect the star and just write m star as n. Hopefully that won't cause any confusion. Here, of course, B is just given by the curl of A in the standard way. Now, given that, what this means is that the different components of velocity don't commute. In fact, they have this commutation relation here. For this problem, we can define several characteristic dimensions. Characteristic frequency is the cyclotron frequency, EB over M, or more accurately, M star, but we're going to call it M. The characteristic length is the magnetic length, H bar over EB. The characteristic velocity is the ratio of, it's omega C times LM, which is this expression here. So let's redefine V in terms of this characteristic velocity. Then, so express everything in terms of the reduced velocity here. Then the commutation relations just come out to be the simple one here, and the Hamiltonian is just this. So we've simply rewritten the original problem in the appropriate dimensionless units. Well, what is this? We've got this commutational relation between two operators. The Hamiltonian is the sum of squares of these operators. Simple harmonic oscillator problem. So we can immediately infer that the possible energy levels here are n plus a half times h bar omega c. Now, that's quite striking. In the absence of a magnetic field, what were our energy levels? Well, they were the usual p squared over 2m, h bar squared k squared over 2m, where k is limited by the boundary conditions. So that means you had a density of states which is proportional to the area and is actually given by this expression here. So you have in fact, you actually have, you see, this doesn't depend on any energy, notice. So in fact, in two dimensions, the density of states is, in the absence of the magnetic field, is simply a constant. Okay? In other words, you've got lots and lots of energy levels, a number proportional to the total area. Now, however, in the presence of the magnetic field, we've immediately inferred that we've got simply these quantized simple harmonic oscillator levels. So what does that mean? That means the new density of states is h bar omega c to minus 1. So that means that the degeneracy per unit area of these states has got to be this number here. In other words, for any given Landau level, that is any particular value of n here, there's exactly one state per flux quantum h over e in the plane. So typically, you're going to have, I mean, your area is going to be macroscopic, you're going to have a huge number, maybe 10 to the 16 or so, of flux quanta. And that means each of these n's here corresponds to 10 to the 16 states, which, however, are all exactly degenerate with one another, to the extent that my plane is uniform. So we define nu as the number of electrons per flux quantum, that is the filling fraction. Notice one thing. Nu, rather generally, is of the order of the Fermi energy divided by the cyclotron energy. Okay. That's basically because you've got to find places for all your electrons, and the number of electrons is determined by the Fermi energy. Now, in a traditional magnetic quantization experiment in three dimensions, like the Haas-Van-Alphen or Shibnikov to Haas, the Fermi energy is about 10 to the 4 k, h bar omega c is about 1 k, so nu is large, of the order of 10 to the 4. However, in two-dimensional systems, say at b, where b equal to 1 tesla, and at coverage about 5 times 10 to the 10th, both of these typical values, then the filling fraction nu is of order 1, not of order 10 to the 4. So this is what, in some sense, this is why you can't practically see the quantum Hall effect in a typical three-dimensional solid. You've got to go to this two-dimensional situation.
So is what you're suggesting here that in a three-dimensional solid, the quantum Hall effect could be seen at certain...
Well, no, I don't think it really could even there, because you see what happens... Well, okay. If you were to actually go to such huge magnetic fields that h bar omega c is comparable to the Fermi energy, then yes, but these are really of the order of kilotesla and so forth, so not practical. What happens in three dimensions, and you might remember some of these diagrams from standard textbooks, what happens in three dimensions is that your different Landau levels are very, very thickly spaced. So you've got these stacks, as it were, the disks, as it were, stacked on top of one another. And because you started off with the original Fermi sphere, which was pretty much spherical, these disks are filled, how should I put it, in a way which roughly corresponds to the sphere. So the lowest disk is going to be filled up to a large radius, then the next one to a smaller radius, et cetera, et cetera. And you might remember some of these pictures. I'm afraid I've got nowhere to draw them, but otherwise I'd draw them. And you see, that's a much more complicated situation, because now, in some sense, what's happening is that the motion in the third dimension can't be neglected in this case, and is screwing things up.
So is there some sense in which, at these high magnetic fields in three dimensions, what occurs is basically that three dimensions become the two dimensions?
Yeah, so as I say, in a standard magnetic field of the order of 1 tesla or so forth, you have this stack of disks, as it were. In other words, these disks correspond to different motion in the perpendicular direction. Now, if you get to a few kilotesla, then you might actually just end up with the bottom disk only, and then you would really be back to the quantum Hall situation. It's just, yeah. Why sorry?
Why is this justified like this is the same for 2D systems, not for the 3D?
Physically justified. Well, okay, that was what I was trying to do in the last few arguments. The point is that under standard conditions for a three-dimensional system, the you can't really ignore the motion in the third dimension. That is the cyclotron frequency, that is the frequency explicitly associated with the Landau quantization, is small compared to the maximum energy of motion in the third dimension. That's basically because let's start off with zero magnetic field. In zero magnetic field, in two dimensions, you may well be in a situation where the first excited state in the third dimension is sufficiently high energy that at zero temperature is not occupied. Okay. Then when you quantize things, you've only in some sense got one disk to worry about. They've got a unique state there. In three dimensions, typically the lowest energy of motion in this dimension is small enough and the density of electrons is high enough that there will be occupation of the excited states in this dimension. So that immediately, in some sense, introduces a new label, a new degree of freedom into your problem. What happens is that instead of having a single set of states in two dimensions, you've got a whole set of different sets of states corresponding to the different motion in the third dimension. So that complicates things. Now, it doesn't mean you can't see interesting effects. I mean, people have been seeing things like the de Haussmann-Alford effect, of course, for many years, but they're more complicated in some sense. Another way of putting it, I think, is this. In some sense, this relates more to the topological aspects of things. In three dimensions, of course, you get quantization in a magnetic field, but it doesn't mean that the semi-classical path of an electron has to come back on itself. That is, an electron can sort of spiral because it can go in the third dimension. In two dimensions, that's not possible. So the moment you put on a magnetic field, all the relevant semi-classical orbits are closed on themselves. And you might, from general experience, expect that that would give rise to interesting effects, and it does. Okay. Very briefly, let's look at the effects of spin. The Zeeman energy, EZ, is G, as before, this. Cyclotron energy is this. They both scale linearly with B. And if we're talking about an electron in free space, they would be comparable. However, because of the small values of G and M star, then the Zeeman energy is much less than the cyclotron energy, roughly this for gallium arsenide. Sorry. So how do we fill up the Landau levels? Well, suppose that we start off with an empty plane, and we start putting in electrons. The first lot of electrons we put in are going to go into the Landau level it has n equals zero, that's the lowest harmonic oscillator level, and has the appropriate spin, the spin, say, parallel to the external field. After I've filled that level, the next set of electrons that are going in will go into the n equals zero orbital Landau level, but now with spin down. There'll be a gap of the order of the cyclotron energy. The next set of electrons have to go up here, and so on and so forth. And so, depending on the value of nu, you can see that you have, first, the simplest case is when nu is less than 1, you have your lowest Landau level partially occupied for the spin-ups only. In this regime, you've got it, the up ones filled, and the down ones partially filled. Nu is between 2 and 3, then both spin states of the lowest Landau level will be filled, and this one is going to be partially occupied, etc., etc. Now, normally, if you were talking about silicon, you'd have to worry about the valley index as well. But now, since most experiments these days are on gallium arsenide, I'll forget about that. If the lowest Landau level is completely filled, then we normally assume it's inert. So you can just take this guy out of the problem and treat this one as if it were the lowest Landau level. In other words, crudely speaking, nu equals 7/3 should be roughly equivalent to nu equals 1/3. Have to be a little careful about that statement. First of all, Coulomb interactions might change this qualitatively. For the moment, remember, we haven't put in any interactions. We're just talking about non-interacting electrons. But the Coulomb interactions could change that. You could have, for example, exchange and therefore spin-dependent effects. Also, the detailed nature of the orbital states are going to be a bit different in this level and this one. One note, it's possible to enhance the Zeeman energy relative to the cyclotron energy by inclining your field to the perpendicular. You see now, if you do this, the orbital motion is only going to see the normal component of the field, whereas the spin component sees the whole field. So, in other words, the problem is equivalent to the original one, provided that I replace B with the perpendicular component and G with G divided by cos theta. Again, have to be a little careful about that. There may be more subtle effects of turning your field around. For example, you can't always assume that the effect of the magnetic field on the ground state motion perpendicular to the slab is necessarily completely negligible. It might not be. And that's a complicating factor. But to a first approximation, this should be true. Okay, we do have to try to acquire some feeling for the Landau level wave functions. Now, an important point to remember here is that you have this huge degeneracy of your Landau levels. That in turn means that it's possible to choose all sorts of different gauges for your magnetic vector potential, and the eigenfunctions which occur in those gauges will in some sense have a different basis. And so they really will look totally different from one another. So for example, if I were to use the so-called Landau gauge, then what I'd actually find is that my energy eigenfunctions are extended in one dimension and confined in a second one. One Cartesian direction and confined in a second one, and so forth. So you have to just choose a convenient gauge. Now, we're going to be talking a lot about cylindrically symmetric situations, so the obvious gauge to choose is a cylindrically symmetric one. So let's choose this so-called symmetric gauge in which the radial component of our vector potential is zero and the tangential component is just a half RB, so it's to give us the right value for B. Sorry? Just the symmetric gauge, I think. I'm not sure. I could be wrong. I could check that. Yeah. It's not the Landau gauge. The Landau gauge is the one in which you you basically have one Cartesian component of x of a fixed non-zero and the other zero. So let's choose this one. Then my time-independent Schrödinger equation in the spherical coordinates comes out to be this here. Because of the spherical symmetry, it's natural to make the ansatz. You have an exponential IL theta in here. And remember that because of the single-valuedness boundary condition, L here has to be integral. Now you get this form of the radial equation expressed in terms of the magnetic length here. Now you'll see this is a sort of potential term which is harmonic, but it's harmonic around a particular radius. And for large L, I think there's a squared. There should be a squared on here. I'm sorry, this has been left off. Yep. So it is harmonic. So the orbit is radially confined close to the bottom of this potential, which is at this point here. So now what's interesting is that the orbit of radius RL encloses exactly this area, that is, it encloses exactly L quanta of flux. In other words, if I could treat my electron as simply moving in the bottom of this potential, moving around in the bottom of this radial potential, It's sort of Mexican hat type of potential. If it was moving exactly in the bottom, it would enclose exactly L quanta of flux. That means that the kinematic angular momentum, which remember is this expression here, is automatically zero, and therefore the angular kinetic energy is also zero. So the only kinetic energy is radial. Now, for large L, we can approximate the derivative here by d squared r by dr squared, and we can expand the potential term. We then just get this this simple harmonic oscillator form of radial equation. It gives us, well, not surprisingly, it gives us the simple harmonic oscillator energy levels here, independently of L. So that's an important point. So n here is the Landau level index. The energy does depend on n. However, within a given Landau level, that is for a given value of n, the energy is completely independent of L, as you'd expect, since we have to produce this massive degeneracy. For smaller L, the energy still turns out to be given by this, but the form of the radial wave function is a bit different. So, but that's not important, because we're almost always going to be interested in rather large values of L. So if I were to draw this in more detail, you'd see that the distances here are not constant. That is, the distances for the lower between the lower curves are larger than the distances of the other curves. That's got to be the case, because I've got to enclose exactly L quanta of flux here. In other words, it's the area which is going up stepwise, not the radius. Okay, so far? So all of this is standard textbook stuff. Now, so far we've simply dealt with a single non-interacting electron. Presumably, to the extent that we can neglect interactions, then all we have to do is to put in our electrons into these states and apply the appropriate Fermi, the Pauli principle appropriately. No. Let's see. What we're doing is, in general, to assume that we have a very large number of flux quanta in our plane. However, we're taking. Implicitly here, I'm assuming a disk geometry. You're right. I should have mentioned that. Okay, so now let's explicitly consider the disk geometry and think about possible explanations of the integral quantum Hall effect. Now, there's a particular geometry which is basically the geometry of an old-fashioned gramophone record. Okay, so it's simply a disk with a hole in the middle. Okay, for some obscure reason, this is called a Corbino disk. I haven't the faintest idea who Corbino is or was, or how he or she got their name attached to this rather simple geometry, but that seems to be the name that's attached to it. So we're going to try to explain the origin of the integral quantum Hall effect in this Corbino disk geometry. For simplicity, let's assume only one spin and value is relevant, and therefore nu is simply the number of electrons divided by the number of flux quanta. So let's consider a fixed value of the flux here. Now, we have to be careful here. We have two different fluxes or fields which we have to consider. We have the field which is actually on the material of the disk here. That's supposed to be constant. The field is B here. And therefore, I have a certain number of flux quanta which are actually distributed over the material of the disk, which, of course, may or may not be integral. It doesn't have to be integral. However, we can also imagine that we can apply an Aharonov-Bohm flux through the hole. You all know, I guess, what an Aharonov-Bohm flux is. It means simply that while there is a finite flux here, it does not generate a field on the surrounding disk. And we can arrange for this to be time dependent. So let's consider the a fixed value of phi. Now we know where it's set in the argument of the last. Yes.
That's time dependent flux.
Yes. Yes.
Now, and Gauss's law says if I'm increasing the flux inside, I'm bringing third lines in through the disk.
Wait a moment. Are you sure that's right? You can't make it appear out of nowhere, but. I think with the Helmholtz coil, surely, you can arrange that any field which is generated is only generated within the hole. Aren't you? No, but I think... Okay, I'm afraid I'm not terribly good at thinking in terms of field lines, so I'm finding this is a bit difficult to deal with. I would have thought this is a point which, of course, has come up, as you probably know, has come up a lot in discussions about the significance of the Aharonov-Bohm effect and whether people have really seen it experimentally and so forth. Okay, I think for the moment at least, let me stick by my original statement, which is that even in a time-dependent situation, my impression was that the only place where the field lines appear and disappear, as it were, is within the hole in the middle. But I have to say, I mean, Well, sure, that would be true of a single wire, but now it is, yes. It's a sort of pair. Helmholtz pair is a pair of these things, yes. Exactly. Yeah, no, I totally agree. But I was under the impression, at least, that that the whole point of a Helmholtz coil is that even in a time-dependent situation, you don't have to have anything happening outside, as it were. Now, but that could be wrong. I really need to think about that, to be honest.
Well, I mean, if you have a toroidal solenoid,
yep.
Like, you can arrange things so that all the field lines are confined to the interior of the solenoid.
Yes.
But when you switch it on, the field lines still have to be moved into the empty space from the coils.
But suppose you've got two...
Yes.
Okay, good question. I think it goes through the disk. Yes. Oh no, then I agree. Sure. So let's imagine that we do have a geometry where it goes through. Yep, that works. Okay, so now remember that in the argument of the last slide, I didn't say that the number of flux enclosed had to be integral, and in general it doesn't. But what I do know is that my orbits always enclose L quanta of flux. So if phi is constant, then this is this is the form of our wave function. There's no current in either. You remember there's no current in the angular direction because the canonical part of the momentum was exactly cancelled by the vector potential part. And there's fairly obviously no current in the radial direction because the harmonic oscillator wave functions are finite. Are restricted in that direction. Now let's imagine that we gradually close the phi AB, the Aharonov-Bohm flux, keeping B, of course, constant, and crucially assume that the eigenstates evolve adiabatically. In other words, at any particular time, to an excellent approximation, the wave function is simply the ground state wave function for that value of the flux. Now, because I'm varying the flux in time, the voltage around the disk is going to be d phi by dt. The question is, what's the current across the disk here? Now, if each state it contains exactly n electrons, for example, one. Each state contains exactly one electron. Then increasing phi AB by phi zero carries in electrons from the inside of the disk to the outside. So that means that the radial current is n times E divided by tau. So in the case of n equals nu equals 1, just E over tau. One electron crosses from the inside to the outside in every period here. But the period is the flux quantum divided by d phi by dt. That's minus pi zero over V. Stick that in, you find the radial current is given by this expression, and therefore the Hall conductance is n times E squared over h. Well, so far so good. That's fine. But it only works when nu is exactly equal to an integer n. Okay? So how come the experimental plateaus are finite? And that was, I think, the brilliant insight of Loughlin and Halperin way back in 1980. The answer, surprisingly, has to do with disorder. In other words, if you really had no disorder whatever in your system, you would not get the integral quantum Hall effect. What we need to do is to understand the nature of the single particle eigenstates in the presence of disorder. And here, I think a construction due to Halperin is rather useful. It's just a way of, in some sense, visualizing what's going on. He said, look, let's replace the real disorder, which is, of course, scattered over the whole disk, by a model in which we have an inner region of the disk, which is free of disorder, and an outer region, and then there's this intermediate ring in which there is disorder. That means that certainly all states in here are going to be extended over the whole volume, the whole area. All states here are similarly going to be extended. What about the states in here? That's the interesting question. That they have an amplitude of order 1 over the whole volume, the whole area of the disk. Okay, so the question is, what are the eigenstates like in the presence of impurity potentials? And this is, in some sense, a whole subject in its own right, but crudely speaking, the answer goes something like this. Imagine, say, you have the impurities are going to give rise to, as it were, hills and valleys in the potential. So suppose we have a hill here and a valley here. So it turns out that in the presence of a magnetic field, there are going to be several kinds of orbits. There are going to be orbits which are confined close to the hill or close to the valley here. And they're going to circulate around. And in fact, it turns out, it's not immediately obvious, but sort of plausible, it turns out the direction of circulation around the hill is opposite to the direction of circulation around the valley. At the same time, there are also going to be orbits which are, in some sense, mostly ignore these hills and valleys and are extended over the whole sample. Now, what is not completely obvious, but does come out from a more detailed examination, is that there is a separation in energy, as it were, between these different kinds of state. Crudely speaking, you find that you get that the states corresponding to circulation around a valley in the potential are localized at the bottom of the band. The states corresponding to circulation around the hill are localized near the top of the band. And in between are the states which are extended over the whole system. So that's not perhaps immediately obvious. It's sort of plausible, though, because the moment that you could actually mix, if two states are nearly degenerate in energy, then you're certainly going to be able to mix them, as it were. And the moment you mix this guy with an extended state, then it's itself going to be extended. So it's at least plausible, if not not rigorous, that's true. So what we find, then, is that in any given Landau level, there are going to be these localized states at the top of the bottom, and in the middle, there are going to be extended states. So now imagine that we start off, say, in the lowest Landau level, so no electrons there at all. And now, a very important point here before I go on. The localized states, let's go back for a moment. The localized states are in some little region here, say, or here. They are not going to be affected by the Aronoff-Bohm flux because they don't enclose it. You remember that the Arona-Bohm effect essentially comes from closed poles which enclose a particular flux. So these don't. So basically, the localized states know nothing about the Arona-Bohm flux. It's only the extended guys that do. And now imagine that we start off from zero electrons and start filling up the lowest lambda level. Initially, we're going to be filling up the valleys. They don't see the Arona-Bohm flux. They're not going to see anything interesting. The thing is just going to depend. They're just going to behave as a rather boring insulator, essentially. Next, we start getting into the region of delocalized states. Now, these guys are certainly going to see, are going to be in some sense sensitive to the Arona-Bohm flux. On the other hand, I think it's pretty, sort of fairly clear that one thing that can't happen here is that the longitudinal conductivity is going to be zero. The reason is that there are always going to be states which are infinitesimally above the occupied states, which are open, so that I can always move electrons, for example, by an electric field, from the occupied states into the unoccupied ones. So in this region, the system is not going to behave in any particularly anomalous way. It's not going to show any kind of quantized Hall effect. Another way of saying this is that you certainly don't have one electron per energy level in this space. You've got some fraction of an electron per energy level. Finally, however, when we've finished filling up these delocalized states, we're going to end up by filling up the hills here. Now our chemical potential is going to lie here. That means that every state, every delocalized state, is going to be occupied by exactly one electron. Therefore, our original argument does work under these conditions. As I vary their Arona-Bohm flux, each of these levels is going to move out adiabatically, and I am going to get precisely the quantized conduction. Now, why under conditions when I get the quantized Hall conductance, why is the longitudinal conductance zero? Well, that's sort of almost trivial because we know that now the chemical potential is in the region of the hills, so all the states here are filled, and by the Pauli principle they've got to stay filled. So an electric field cannot do anything to this. In other words, it's exactly the same as in a standard filled band. Okay, is that relatively clear? Yep. Let's see. Now, that's very interesting. If you had no disorder at all, then basically the situation would be exactly the same as for a classical for a sort of classical three-dimensional case. You just get a uniform slope the whole way. So I think it's the opposite to what you said. This is a very counterintuitive thing. For no disorder, you get zero width to your plateaus. So in some sense, you see, you could say that a good in quotes, quantum Hall system, that is one which has substantial plateaus, must have a lot of disorder.
Can you go over again why, when you build up this middle band, this extended
yeah.
band, suddenly you have one electron per state?
Well, that's just the Pauli principle, basically. But, it does rely essentially on the statement that the different kinds of state are separated in energy here. That is, that the ones which are localized around valleys sit below the extended states, which in turn sit below the ones localized around hills.
Okay, so as you're playing on this band, there's the electrons are able to, because each in the extended states, the bands are so close together that the electrons are free to jump up.
Yeah. Yes, right. So if to the extent that the chemical potential lies within this extended region, you would not expect any interesting quantum Hall effect. Oh, Well, let's just stop for a moment on that, because this is important. Yeah.
I don't know where to go. That's all. I just don't know what question to ask.
Okay. Okay, we can come back to this.
Yeah. Sure.
Okay, so I guess I'm not going to get finished with the whole content of this lecture anyway. But okay, just very briefly, let me just review. We already went through this essentially in lecture one. Let me just again review, because I think it is such a neat argument. So far, the arguments we've used are based entirely on a model of non-interacting electrons, which the only many body effect, if you like, is the Pauli principle. But you notice, incidentally, there is some kind of echo of what we were doing in the first two lectures here. Both in the material of the first two lectures on topological insulators, and also here, it's true that we don't really have to invoke any interactions, but we do have to invoke the Pauli principle in a rather essential way. In both cases, you see, if we didn't have filled bands, then your most of the stuff we talked about in the case of topological insulators would go away, or at least it wouldn't be interesting. Similarly here, if you don't have your extended states completely filled, then nothing interesting happens. Okay, so very briefly, the Thouless topological argument. So what's nice about this argument is that it does not require require us to neglect interactions. It still works in the presence of interactions. So very briefly again, if you're not familiar with this stuff, it probably is too fast, but don't worry too much. As I say, it's just the payoff, which is, I think, rather nice. So you you imagine that you've actually connected up your Hall bar. So we're no longer in a Corbino disk geometry, we have a slightly different geometry. We connected the sides of the bar into a voltage loop and these sides into a current loop. And you apply a flux through the voltage loop, and then by definition, the Hall conductance is just the ratio of ij to d phi v by dt. The perturbation due to phi v is this is standard expression for the effect of a flux through the loop. It's just basically it's just the standard minimal coupling expression integrated. So in linear response theory, you find that the Hall conductance is nothing but the linear response of the voltage, the current through the voltage loop, to the current through the current loop, or actually vice versa. In terms of matrix elements, it's given by this expression where P projects off the ground state. Again, not entirely trivial bit of algebra, you can do it. That reduces to this. That in turn reduces to this. And so you get this expression for the Hall conductance. There is a fundamental assumption involved here, namely that when you've gone through one cycle of both the current and the voltage phases, as it were, your effective fluxes through these two loops have come back to their original values, then the ground state returns to its original value, modulo 2 n pi n phase. So that, in some sense, that's implicitly assumes that you have to have some kind of energy gap in your system. Okay. So if that's true, then the average value of sigma h is given by this expression here, and that is simply equal to an integer times e squared over h. So what this argument seems to be saying, at least at first sight, is that quite generally, under these with these assumptions, irrespective of the details of the geometry and of the bar and so forth, the Hall conductance has to be quantized in integer units of e squared over h. Now, in fact, obviously there's going to be something subtly wrong with this argument, because we know that, in fact, we do have also the fractional quantum effect. But nevertheless, I think it's a very, very neat argument. Okay, so let me... Yep. I probably... as I said, I think I probably should not try to finish all the material I have in this lecture. this time or it'll be too fast. So let me just go a little more leisurely and just at least introduce the fractional quantum Hall effect. Let's start off with the simplest kind of fractional quantum Hall effect, which is the so-called Laughlin states, where the filling fraction is 1 over an odd integer. Now, that appears to be impossible to explain on any non-interacting electron model, because on any non-interacting electron model, the chemical potential would lie in the extended band, and therefore we'd certainly get a longitudinal conductance which is non-zero. And we'd also not in fact get a quantized Hall effect. So let's consider for the moment the case, say, where nu is simply a third or something simple. Let's consider the states of the lowest Landau level only, and let's define, and this is very useful quite generally for a discussion of two-dimensional problems, we introduce a complex variable z, x plus I, y, standard way. And again, we introduce our standard magnetic length here. Now, a possible choice, this is not immediately obvious again, but turns out that a possible choice of the single particle eigenstates of the lowest Landau level is, in fact, this expression here. Now, this expression here does not look, at first sight, exactly like what we had on the earlier view graph. Let's go back to that for a moment. It doesn't immediately look like this. But if you think about it, you see it does have the right factor, exponential I L theta. Remember, z to the L, z is R e to the I theta. So z to the L does contain a factor of e to the I L theta. And it also contains a radial factor, which, now that's, okay, we have to go back for that. You see, it turns out that this factor here is essentially the radial factor we wrote down before. However, there is the restriction, of course, that L has to fit within the area of the disk. Now, you remember that L enclosed, the Lth orbital enclosed L quanta of flux. So that says the maximum value of L has to be the area divided by the flux quantum. Now, suppose that the Coulomb interaction, this is a non-trivial point. How does the Coulomb interaction compare with the cyclotron energy? Well, again, that depends on the exact values of your parameters, but you see that this quantity depends only on the mean distance between electrons, which is a function of the filling fraction. This quantity depends on the magnetic field. So by making the magnetic field large enough, we should be able to get it under these conditions. And if we are under these conditions, then it's reasonable to try to form the many-body ground state out of combinations of states in the lowest Landau level without invoking higher Landau level states. And now at this point, we basically have to, historically we had to make a guess. We, in this case, being Bob Laughlin. He made the following brilliant guess. He said, look, we'd like to use states only out of this lowest Landau level. On the other hand, we'd like to minimize the Coulomb interaction. Now, of course, to some extent, the Coulomb is, since we're dealing with parallel spin, remember we only have one spin state involved here, we're dealing with parallel spins, the Pauli principle already will tend to keep electrons apart to some extent. So it will tend to suppress the Coulomb interaction, but we'd like to do better than that. So now if all we had was the Pauli principle, then the relative wave function, ask what happens when Zi, the two electrons tend to coincide in their values of Z, that is Z1 and Z2 approach one another, okay? How is the wave function going to behave? Well, if all we had was the special case, which is the integral quantum Hall effect, Then it turns out not surprisingly, that the wave function would simply decrease proportional to the distance between the z's. In other words, it simply goes zi minus zj. Okay, fine. But why don't we try to do better than that? Why don't we try to put in a higher power of zi minus zj so that to suppress the wave function more effectively as they get close together and thereby decrease the Coulomb energy? So Laughlin said, let's suppose that we have an expression that the correlated wave function is a sort of, the word for this, which I forgot, isn't entering my mind. Jesper wave function. It has this factor here, which essentially you always have to put in, whether you like it or not, in anything to do with the Hall effect. But it also has this factor here, where Q is an odd, now Q has to be an odd integer, because you do want to respect the antisymmetry of the wave function, that is the Pauli principle. The integral quantum Hall effect actually turns out to be a special case. You could just rewrite by just writing down your many-body wave function, just messing around with it. You could actually rewrite the Laughlin wave function in this form with Q equal to 1. However, what we now want to do is to make Q different from 1. So let's imagine that Q is some odd integer here. So this is Laughlin's famous trial wave function. It has some interesting features. Despite appearances, it is nearly spatially uniform in density. You might think that this factor was going to screw up the uniformity, but it turns out not. If you just rearrange the exponent here, it turns out that the only non-uniform term is this one, which involves the total center of mass coordinate. Now you see, if you just move one electron, say, across the disk, you only change this by of order 1 over n. So this factor changes by a totally insignificant amount. So it really is pretty much spatially uniform. Now, a crucial point, however, is the filling factor nu is not arbitrary for the following reason. The maximum power of any given zj in this wave function is actually n minus 1 q, but people usually say n q since n is huge here. It's equal to n q. On the other hand, the largest value of L, which you're allowed to have in your first Landau level, is A divided by phi 0. And therefore, you must get this relation that n q is A over phi 0, which simply says that the filling factor nu is simply the inverse of this q. So for example, if you had nu equals 1/3, then Q here would be 3, etc., etc. So you're always suppressing the relative wave function as the two electrons get close together by an effect which goes beyond the original Pauli principle suppression. And this is why Laughlin thought this might be a reasonable guess at the ground state wave function. And indeed, people have actually done numerical simulations with up to something like, I think, 18 or 20 electrons now, and it does appear to be a very, very good ground state wave function for that system. So this really is a very impressive example of a case in which, a very rare example actually in condensed matter physics, in which you could guess a non-trivial form of the ground state wave function, and it does appear to coincide to what nature actually does, at least to a very high degree of approximation. Okay, well, as I said, I don't think I'm going to finish. I'm certainly not going to finish, in fact, this. Okay, yeah, we've got some quite important stuff still left to discuss. the very important consideration concerning quasi-particles in the fractional quantum Hall effect. We have to discuss also, briefly at least, the so-called Jane states, that is the fractional quantum Hall effect states which are not simple Laughlin states. And then I would like to discuss, at least briefly, the evidence for fractional, as we'll see, the Laughlin quasi-particles, or more generally, the fractional quantum Hall effect, quasi-particles are generally believed to have non-integral charge and non-integral statistics. We need to discuss the experimental evidence for that statement. So there's really quite a lot of material, in fact, that I hadn't covered, and I'm going to have to put that in the next lecture and squeeze out some of the stuff I was intending to put in there, I guess. Looks like right now, as you've probably gathered by now, I'm sort of winging this slightly in the sense that I'm just tried, not always sure how much time some of this material is going to take. I think it looks now as if we're going to end up with something like 10 lectures in total. But I will. What I'm going to try to do, apart from this, is to cover the general some general considerations concerning non-abelian anions and how we might use them for quantum computing, and talk at least somewhat about both the some of the formal models, like the Kitaev-Honeycomb model, and also about real-life possible exemplifications of non-abelian anions, like the so-called five halves quantum Hall effect, like the so-called P plus IP Fermi superfluids, etc. And then finally, the most recent and most topical subject, which is these semiconductor superconductor hybrid, where allegedly at least one gets Majorana fermions. So I think this should probably take about a total of about 10 lectures. But oh yeah, absolutely. I should do that myself. Actually, you mean putting them on online?
Yeah,
absolutely. Yes, I agree. I really should have done that by now. I'll talk to Monica and see. I'm sure she'll send me to the right person. Any general questions, comments, objections?